linear, you don't want to perturb it too much, so you drop the higher order term. Exactly as in the case of nuclear magnetic resonance, where you have the oscillatory radio frequency field, and you work to linear order in the amplitude of that radio frequency field. Not the same one field, but the radio frequency field. So you drop this. And now you're going to treat this as perturbation. Now the reason I'm puzzled now, because see, what do you see here? The electron is a quantum mechanical system. It exists in a certain energy state. And because of this perturbation or shining of light, it will go into another state. So it takes a transition. So you have to calculate the transition probability. And my problem today now is that if I ask you, do you remember what is the Fermi system? So this is what is the interaction term. It is simply stated. But let me ask you, so physically what is happening? You already know physically what is happening because I have an electron, I can have a molecule. For the solar pulse system is an atom, let's say atom itself is so complicated, it showed us. Then we have a molecule, then a molecule of the solid, like a hydrogen solid or not, we discussed it yesterday. But now we go to this fundamental thing, I shine light, these electrons in either an atomic system or a molecular system would be jiggled. Because there will be a force due to the electric component and there will be force due to the magnetic field component. They jiggle, they get into accelerated mode. What happens if they're in accelerated mode? A charged particle getting accelerated?
Radiation.
Will radiate. That is how the variable energy factor comes in Kolkata. So that's how cyclotrons work. This is how synchrotron works. Because charged particle radiates and you capture that radiation and you use it. Because D.T. Sharma, the world's expert on that, travels from place to place, Japan or Hamburg, to do this experiments where you get these photons coming out of that accelerator and use those photons in the photo emission experiments. So therefore, that's how cyclotrons work. So now, I therefore would write down this interaction term. And so what is this interaction term? So it's minus E over mc, okay? And I have a vector potential, so we have an amplitude of the vector potential. Now electromagnetic field is a field, right? Just as in quantum mechanics, when you write down the wave function, you have a phase, you also have an amplitude, you have an amplitude, and you have a phase. So you have e to the I, omega I c. I'll write it in one rotation. You might have seen this. So when you see this, like Vithika says, that when I tell you this, it triggers something in her head. So okay, sorry, I jumped the gun. So I have E dot P, and I have a time dependent. Lambda, so that it depends on the wavelength, any kind of wave, sound, light, anything. Okay? And also has a frequency. And there's a wavelength and frequency relationship, which is for light, it is C is equal to nu lambda. Now nu is what? The relation of nu and omega. Omega by 2 pi times lambda, and lambda by 2 pi by lambda is actually k. So omega is also kc for light, because light propagates, well, electromagnetic field propagates the speed of light. This is Einstein's special theory of relativity. Okay, so this is now your interaction to linear order in the electromagnetic field where you have neglected this term. Okay, so now what is happening is that you have, so you physically interpret this as your light comes, it has got a certain wavelength and it's got a certain frequency. These are things that can be manipulated in the laboratory. Like you can have a tuned lasers where you can manipulate the frequency of various things. So you can manipulate omega. So this is where the energy is hidden in, because the light is carrying a photon energy of h bar omega. So this then will be either consumed by your electronic system or given up. So one process is called absorption, the other is an emission. And if I have absorption, then this is what you do in infrared absorption, for instance, microwave absorption. These are all only names which are given because they operate in different frequency regimes or different wavelength regimes. Or nuclear magnetic resonance absorption, okay, where you have, let's say, the frequencies will be in the radio frequency regime. So you actually work with one of them, and this is a quantum operator here. Because P, what is P in quantum mechanics? P is minus IH bar grad, right? Is DDX operator, Mithika, So this is a quantum operator. And so what, and Professor Sharma will deal with in great detail. So suppose the system initially was in a state I, and you make a transition to a final state F, okay? So it's a quantum transition initiated by this operator. So you have to sandwich these things, and now I will use words. I, this operator P that will go in, of course dotted with A, and the direction of the vector, now okay. Again, some basic electromagnetic field. But because light, electromagnetic field moves the speed of light, what is the nature of that wave? It's always a transverse wave as opposed to sound wave. Sound can have longitudinal and transverse, meaning that the direction of propagation is always at right angles to the plane in which the electric and magnetic fields lie. So therefore, your vector potential is, in, let's say, in this plane. The direction of propagation is determined by the k vector, okay? And that's normal, that is perpendicular. It is customary to take the direction of the a vector or the direction of the e vector, the electric field, as what you call polarization. Right? Electromagnetic field is polarized. If it is linearly polarized, or because it's in the plane, it can also rotate, and so you will get also circular polarization, right? And you're routinely using this in all kinds of biprisms, experiments, everything, right? So the point that is being made is that we are dealing with operators, and when you complete this square, you have to be careful about the operator. So it's not just P dot A, but you there's a factor 2 here, and it's P dot, I've been a little casual here, and it's A dot
E. Is coming on that side.
So therefore, that is how the other term is coming here, and it's P dot A plus A dot P, because vector potential has some coordinates hidden on it. Unless there were some coordinates hidden on it, by taking curl, you would not get a constant magnetic field, for instance, right? You're taking a derivative, so you must have some coordinate, right? Like, for instance, your gauge invariance, so this is what is called the gauge invariance, that the fact that the vector potential can be altered by the gradient of a scalar, And that's why you can work in different gauges. Like this is what is called the symmetry gauge, minus half yb, half xb, 0. How do I write it? How do I know? You simply take curl. Class 11 exercise. Take curl, you'll see constant magnetic field along the z-axis. Or by simply adding a grad, which is of the form half bxy, you will get another vector potential. You from this A, go to another A, which is minus yb, 0, 0, and this is called the Landau gauge. So you can already see that in the coordinate, in the components of the vector potential, x and y, etc. are hidden. So they depend on position coordinates, and what the Dirichlet's point was that p and x, px doesn't commute with x, py doesn't commute with y. Therefore, you have to be careful about the order in which you are taking. And so you do p dot a plus a dot b, a dot p. One of the terms will give you this, other terms will give you that. Okay? Now, so we have very limited time. So what you are doing is that you are making a transition possible. So you have to write down a probability amplitude. Because in quantum mechanics it says that you write a probability amplitude for going from this state to that state. So you have to sandwich between I and F an operator which makes this transition possible. And that's your interaction amplitude. And then the golden rule says that if you do first order time dependent perturbation theory, then the probability of transition per unit time for going from state I to state F is a matrix amplitude square, mod square. You simply don't have one particular level to the excited state. You have to sum or integrate over many such levels, right? And so you get into issues of density of states, sum them over. And in the photoelectron spectroscopy, Professor G.D. Sharma, and I learned something also in the morning when we were taking a walk to the Horinghatta orchards along with my erstwhile physics colleagues here, in one set of experiments, the ejected electron moves with so rapidly that your final states are like free electron states out in the continuum. Okay? That is a different physics than if the electron actually is slow and it spends more time before it gets out, and that is a matter of important details in the experimental scenario. All these things, I hope, that will come out. I had more items on the notes, but actually, there is very little point in going into the technicalities if you have not seen these things. So, yeah, I mean, mostly a photoelectric effect, when the what you have to do with the electron move gets ejected with rapidity, then you have to really basically count the possible states within a cone, okay? You have to count possible states where the final state momentum is, let's say, kf, and this is like counting of states. Now, have you seen how, suppose you have three particle solution of Schrodinger equation, three electrons, in a box? Have you seen what's called periodic boundary condition? Why the values of k get quantized? What is the meaning of periodicity? So that allows you to count the number of possible states. You need that in everywhere. I mean, you try to calculate heat capacity of solids or something. You have to do it for quantums. Kittel. Yeah. So you have to do similar exercise here. Get these things. And then the thing that I learned also in the morning is that it is clear that you're going to map out the electron charge distribution here. So therefore you can do a static experiment where you basically integrate out over all this omega. You know, if you integrate out into the I omega t over all omega, then what do you get? How many of you have seen a delta function? No. So you get a static picture, but there are instances, as I learned, where you can, in fact, you look at the internal dynamics where omega comes in a more stringent manner, and you can do dynamic effects. So these are buzzwords like you do look at either a static kind of structure factor or a dynamical structure factor. These are common languages in scattering experiments, neutron, X-ray.